location of this hallway doesn't matter. This hallway as it is the smoothed out vastness of eternal joy. If you can't get to all these videos, that's fine. I've been taping a tremendous amount, making a final push before President's Day. I've said that President's Day is the crucial day, and indeed it is. I had a dream last night. There's this massive storm coming in. It's supposed to start up in the north and then gradually start hitting us down here. What happened was it suddenly started hitting us prematurely, or at least according to the forecast. Very hard, very hard. I saw a huge palm tree, a beautiful huge, with a massive canopy protection. I got under that palm tree protection from this tremendous rain that is coming. It's a rain of error, a rain of error. We have been preparing for this. I've been warning everyone. I was able to get this technique grounded here, the continuity technique. And so everything is ready. Everything is ready. And the blitzkriegs always come before you think they're going to come. You know that something's coming. The whole idea of a blitzkrieg is to come early, surprise everybody, and panic them. Okay, but we are not panicked by this. What is the reign of error? Well, we know what that is. It is an attempt to turn us away from the Holy Spirit, away from spiritual healing, healing of the mind, healing of the spirit, which is the only healing there is. The only healing we need from this dream of separation that we have is to awaken from the dream. And we have, the only problem we have is a continuity problem that we're afraid, we can't remember what reality's like, so we're scared to awaken. It's the only problem we have. It's the only healing we really need at all. The reign of error is being brought from many different directions on this planet. And they have been frantically indoctrinating the planet as much as possible so that the population of this planet has been indoctrinated to believe that real spiritual healing is completely bogus. Right, and they want you to turn to physical healing, in other words, pharmaceuticals, physical modalities, biochemistry, biotechnology, all those types of therapies. There's so many, 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 many. And they also want you to, they insist that any happiness or joy you feel has to be completely expressed through the body. Okay, this is another one of their false tenets, which trap you. Because as soon as you start to feel a universal joy, eternal life, you say, well, I can't express that through the body. You know, I can't do it through music, through dance, through romance, through shouting or eating, whatever. It's way too much to express through the body. So we are taught to drop that, say, no, that's unallowable. Because we're taught that the body is our identity, you know, which is totally untrue. So this rain of error is raining down, will begin to rain down on us in a physical way. Okay, before we've just seen all these dark clouds that are scaring us. Now there's going to be actual impact upon the physicality situation here. Which, of course, we expected, but I'm saying I was shown that this time, what is it, the 17th of February, President's Day, it's going to start. And in the dream, it did start. So what do? We take refuge. We take refuge. Plain and simple, we take refuge. Refuge is possible. It will happen. It may even be a physical refuge at this point. And so we will know who did their homework and who did not. What I get in this world is everyone insists that they're prepared. You know, everyone feels they're prepared. But we'll find out who actually did their homework at this time. Now, I always feel like I should have done much, much more, of course. So I don't know if I've done sufficient or not. We'll find out. Everybody will find out at this time. Let me just address certain issues here. For instance, let's address the church, the Roman Catholic Church, the churches in general, religions in general. What I've seen is they have fallen into the trap of pride in that they say, well, we have been here for so long. We've proved ourselves that we can can defeat any, you know, enemies. That we don't have to, we're not worried, you know. We have been here for so long that for sure we're going to continue on. There's nothing that can defeat us. This is called pride. That's not based on reason at all, right? Reason would say, well, let me assess the strengths that we have right now and then the strengths of those who are trying to topple us and find out, do we have the strength right now? What is the strength of our adversary, for instance? You have to know that. But the church is not doing that. They're just saying, look, longevity is going to win out. We're going to be here forever. No worries. This is not a rational viewpoint at all. And so they're not applying themselves in an all-out effort because that hurts their pride. They want to say, look, we're not worried. We don't need to make an all-out effort. We're not threatened at all. And so pride goeth before a fall. And pride and longevity is a very, very bad pride. And that's what I see happening in the church. Also, in this world, what I see taking place, a great error, is a battle of who has the strongest projection. And this relativity called duality is projection, say, well, we have the best projection, therefore our projection is right and yours are wrong, therefore our projection works and yours don't. But the fact is, no projections work, okay, except the projection that the Holy Spirit has, because God created the Holy Spirit to give us that one projection, which is called the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness. Only that works. Nothing else works. All other projections are failures. Okay, are failures. But what I see is what we do in the world is we try to find the best projection, what we think is the strongest projection, and then claim that we're loyal to this projection, and that this project, that therefore we have the best projection, so therefore we win, we triumph. And this triumph of our best projection means that we're somehow, what? We win. What do we win? Well, it's always in the future, isn't it? We never quite get our prize, but we think that others are depriving us of the prize. We project that frustration out on them, and we continue to conflict and attack them and engage in this attack mode. That's what I've seen. So that's called duality. Duality is to say which lie is the best lie. And the other lies are, it's called relativism. It says this lie, we got the best lie, the most plausible lie, the strongest lie, so all the other lies are no good, but so then you have a half truth. You have, you know, that if a lie is somehow better than other lies, and this makes the lie true, that's this whimsical reasoning, lack of reasoning. Whim is a lack of reason, and so we engage in this duality of triumph over other lies, thinking that we have the best lie, we have the best projection. This is the habit of this world. This is the ideology of this world. Who has the best sacrifice? In other words, we're all competing. Who has the best sacrifice? Projection. Projection is sacrifice. Who has the ultimate sacrifice? Okay, they say, okay, we're winners. So if you have the best lie, what do you win? Does that solve the continuity problem? Does that solve the continuity problem? Is the only question you need to ask yourself. Does this solve the continuity problem? Say, the only problem I have is the continuity problem. Does this solve the continuity problem right now? Perfectly. Is that solving? No. Only the vision of oneness solves the continuity problem. This is what the great realizers have told us. This is what I have seen. This is what I believe. This is where my faith is. Only the vision of oneness solves the continuity problem. And the continuity problem is the only problem we have. So our total attention and valuing needs to be towards the vision of oneness, not on who has the best, most powerful projection, who has the best magic, you know. That's useless. Now, this con- continuity technique is an amazing technique, and I'm discovering more and more and more. Why is it so effective? Well, one of the ways, it has effectiveness on many levels, but let me discuss one right now. And that is, what we're really doing is we're disengaging from the ego, disengaging from duality. The ego wants to engage us in judgment about which lie is the most powerful lie. Okay, which lie is the most powerful lie? Which deception, which projection is the most powerful projection? But we already know the answer to that, which is the vision of oneness is the only effective, quote-unquote, projection, because it's still perception that there is. Because only that reminds us of reality. Only that enables us to awaken from the dream. So the ego wants to engage us in something other than the vision of continuity problem, vision of oneness. And so what we do, and so it raises problems. It's like, hey, you got an escape problem, don't you? I mean, and you say, no, I don't have an escape problem. My only problem is the continuity problem. The escape problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And it gives the ego nothing to grab a hold of. Cannot engage your mind in that way. And then the ego says, well, you got a refuge problem, right? I want to help you with your refuge problem. You say, no, I don't have a refuge problem. I have a continuity problem. The refuge problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And again, the ego can't engage your mind with that. And then the ego will even try to engage you, say, well, you say you have a continuity problem. And you say, no, I don't have a continuity problem. I have a continuity problem. See, the continuity problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. So even there, you don't engage the ego. And the ego says, well, you got a safety problem, right? You say, no, I don't have a safety problem. I only have a continuity problem. The safety problem has no value to me. Only the vision of oneness has value to me. What you're doing here is you're literally taking refuge. It is a technique that by doing, you are taking refuge, because you're not engaging with the ego, which is duality, which is trying to develop a greater lie, okay, a half-truth, a greater half-truth, greater magic. And you're trying to make distinctions between what is the same. The way that we get delayed is by trying to make distinctions of differences, distinctions between what is the same, and not making a distinction between what is different. The Holy Spirit's projection is different than the ego's projection, okay? It's the final projection, it's the final illusion. It's the one illusion projection which reminds us of reality to such a wonderful extent that we're able to drop the dream altogether. Dream of separation, the dream of trying to be greater than God, the whim. We're able to drop that altogether eventually. So that's different. That is different. And so the ego wants to engage us in thinking about differences where actually, there are no differences, no effectual differences, merely meaningless, superficial packaging differences. It's like there's all these packages, and the ego says, "Okay, which package is better? Which do you like better? I'll help you get that package wherever you want." Whereas inside the package, it's the exact same worthlessness in every package. But the packaging is all different. So this technique is simply whatever arises as a problem or an issue in your mind, whatever it is, you deny it. You say, I don't have that problem. I don't have that problem. In other words, no dialogue with the ego. This is refuge. I don't have a contest problem. I don't have a triumph problem. I have a continuity problem. It's very severe, extreme severe, yes, but it's the only problem I have. And see, we know we do have a problem, right? So the ego tries to trick us into turning to the ego for advice. So by saying, yes, I do have a problem, the continuity problem, and it's very severe, in fact, it's the most severe problem there is, that deflates the ego. It can't hook you anymore, right? Because if you deny that you're, say, I don't have any problem, inside you know you do. And so the ego will say, well, okay, oh really? And well, that's great. And then it'll start talking with you, and you feel like you're getting pulled into its web of deceit. And eventually you'll start listening to its advice. So what this technique does is it frees us up from the ego, takes refuge from the ego, mental refuge, spiritual refuge from the ego. You say to the ego, no, I don't have that problem. In other words, you deny the ego right off. Start off denying the ego access to you. You say, no, I don't have that problem. The continuity problem is the only problem that I have. It's a vast, intense, severe problem. Yes, I have that problem, but it's the only problem I have. What can the ego do then, you see? You're admitting you have a very severe problem, but you are defining what the problem is, not the ego. And by you defining your problem as only the continuity problem, you're on the same page as the Holy Spirit. And then you are opening the door. The door will open to the vision of oneness for you. And then you will know for sure that this is the remedy to your problem. For sure you will know it's the remedy. I've already experienced that to a slight extent, the dawning of the vision of oneness. And I saw it and I said, for sure that's the remedy to all our problems. But the problem we have, the continuity problem, really, it is the remedy. It is the remedy. So this is a spiritual technique to take refuge from the ego, from error, from bad advice, actually. Very bad advice. Which is just to project more, and come up with the winning projection. The winning lie. Congratulations, you have the winning lie. What do you win? Well, the ego says, well, you get to dwell with that lie forever. And so it's eternal lie. But we're still attracted by eternal life, because that's what all there is. So we eventually say, that's not what I really want. Now, the refuge of this time could have a physical component to it. That is possible. I don't know for sure, but that possibility needs to at least be, you know, your mind says, you know, okay, if that's part of it, that's fine. It might be part of it. We have been under this onslaught already for a long time, but what I'm saying is now there is going to be you're going to feel direct impact upon yourself, rather than just these dense clouds that we have been seeing for so long in this severe indoctrination program. That there's going to be action. From this point forward, it is going to be a time of action. And that you do need to take refuge from it, or else you're going to get battered. You don't want to get battered. That's what I was feeling. I was getting hit by the rain. I said, whoa, this rain is hitting real hard. Just even though you have a raincoat on, okay, I had a raincoat, the actual physical battering that the rain was hitting me so hard, I said, I got to get out of this rain. It's too heavy. So there may be a relocation component to this. There may be. Don't worry about this, because what I've showcased here is that right teaching will be there for sure. If there's a relocation, hopefully I'll be there, and there may probably be many others. And there'll be a right teaching, maybe there'll be different styles, okay? You'll be able to find the style that works for you. And you'll be able to calm down. And what calming down is essentially is overcoming the fact that you're no longer close to the ego's advice. Okay, the ego's advice is not so available to you anymore. That's what you need to calm down from. So that's why we needed to practice not taking the ego's advice. We need to practice, so that when we take refuge, it'll feel fine. You say, well, the ego's advice isn't here because there's no real problems here as far as the living. It's okay because we've already practiced not using the ego's advice. And by spiritual practice, this technique, that is practicing, you're not taking the ego's advice. You're blocking it. You're blocking it. Say, no, I don't need your advice on this. I don't have that problem. So why do I need your advice? It has no value. The ego, your advice, ego, has no value because I don't have that problem. See, this is the technique. And in the realms of refuge, there aren't the problems that we have here. They're not there. But you still have a continuity problem, okay? You still have a continuity problem, absolutely, okay? In the realms of refuge, you still have a continuity problem. Therefore, you still have a need to work on that continuity problem through right spiritual practice, absolutely. But you don't have the threat that you have here to what we term our well-being and our general physical basic well-being. You don't have those threats. You don't have those threats. So you don't need the advice of the ego how to deal with those threats. Now, if you're used to following the advice of the ego, you will feel like, oh my gosh, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do, I don't know what to do, I gotta leave here, I don't know what to do here, I don't know what to do. I feel intense boredom or not knowing what to do, scary. I need to go. You think, I don't have an advisor here, where's my advisor? Because there's no call for your advice, the ego there. So if you want to take refuge in the higher, realms of refuge, you do have to be able to engage in right spiritual practice because the other threats are not present. So by doing these exercises, you are literally practicing to get into the realms of refuge for sure. Which is why I've been taping so much lately. It's practice, more intense practice. You don't need the ego's advice at all, because you don't have those problems. I don't have a survival problem. I only have a continuity problem. That's my only problem. I don't have a health problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have a functionality problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have a relationship problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have a dependency problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have an unconsciousness problem. I only have a continuity problem. I don't have a coma problem. I only have a continuity problem. So all the stuff that the ego is so eager to advise you on, the ego's very eager to advise you. It's got all this technology now. The ego says, I'm going to just give you so much advice, you won't believe how much advice I'm giving you. And of course, the ego thinks that the quantity is all that matters. If it gives you just a massive amount of advice that has to be right, overlooking the quality entirely, upside down and backwards. That's the same thing as what coming up with the ultimate projection and then claiming victory. That's all you need. All you need is victory over other projections. And then that's your salvation. That's what the ego tells us. Its advice is incredibly wrong. 100% wrong. And not only that, but going in the wrong direction, 100% in the wrong direction, even though it puts window dressing and packaging on it to make it, put spiritual packaging on it. But inside the package, it's still the wrong direction. So for me, I know that there's at least one technique that I can use in the realms of refuge that leads me to the vision of oneness. You don't need a whole bunch of different techniques. You just need one. Just need one is all that's necessary. So I know that I have one. And I'm just sharing with the world that there is at least one technique. There might be millions, I don't know. Different styles for different people have different styles, right? Just like music, people like different music. There's some music that a lot of people like that just seems to really be really good. So there may not be millions of styles, there may be just a few. Just a few, possible. Or there may just be one, I don't know. Doesn't matter. As long as you have one technique that works, none of the other issues matter at all. Doesn't matter. You don't have to be an expert on all techniques. You only need to be an expert on one. And I have seen that this continuity technique works. It works. It works. Gotten right to this point of dawning, and I've actually taken a glimpse, you know, and seen, so, oh my gosh, it's universal happiness, universal joy, eternal life. Everything as it is in the arms of everywhereness. And you literally can see this and experience it. Absolutely nothing has ever been lost or ever can be lost. Everything is entirely in the arms of God. Even though they're all sleeping and dreaming that they're not, they still are. And you can see that. You see it. You're no longer fooled by appearances. Instead of seeing things as primary, you see this pure spaciousness as primary. This everywhereness is primary. Instead of seeing location as primary, you see everywhereness as primary. So right spiritual practices are absolutely possible to engage in. You won't get bored, and you will find that as you start getting traction, you will say, wow, I want to keep doing this. This is great, because you're moving towards seeing beyond appearances, seeing everywhereness as primary. That is the one condition that there is. And specific locations don't mean anything in terms of everywhereness, have no meaning whatsoever. None. So this whole relativistic mindset, you transcend it, you set it down, you exchange it for a non-relativistic perspective, which is called vision of oneness. Vision of oneness is a non-relativistic mindset. This is what is necessary. The relativistic mindset is going to cause you to sink and drown here. Drown in a sea of emotion and emoting and drama and all this kind of stuff. Whereas the vision of oneness is this totally smoothed out richness, where totally non-relativist, it's not relativistic, location has absolutely no relevance or meaning whatsoever. So you're free. You're free of this whole location thing, this whole location as identity thing. I'm a thing, meaning I'm a location. I am not a location. I am everywhere. In fact, there's only everywhereness. Location is totally irrelevant. Here comes the cat again. The cat is coming for the practice.
Very good.
Sailing in. Duality is relativistic, isn't it? It's comparative. It says, well, you're a location, I'm a location. You're a thing, I'm a thing. You're a projection, I'm a projection. Now, who has the best location? Who has the... who's going to be the winner in location? And happiness is relative. I have happiness here, you don't have happiness over there. I have more here, you have less there. All of that, that terrible relativism which we've been trapped in, which of course is turmoil, is turmoil. Is competition, is turmoil. Whereas non-relativism, location, everyone is. There is no location. There's only, everything is the heart. Is the center. There's not even any center. It's even beyond that. This is everywhereness. I mean, we're dwelling in everywhereness right now. So, but back to the technique, which is what everyone really needs to practice. Because it's practicing no longer relying on the ego for advice, is what it's really practicing. And of course the ego is not going to tell you about this technique. It's not going to tell you how to get free of relying on its advice. It wants you to be addicted to its advice forever, because it thinks it's God. Because that's our projection. Actually, our projections are designed to defend us from God, protect us from God. So we think the ego is a new God who's capable of defending us from any attack that God makes upon us. And of course, God is not making any attack at all. We're the ones who try to attack God in our attempt, an attempt to be greater than God. And then we projected our attempt onto God and then claimed that God was trying to do it to us. That's the root projection that has led to all these other projections. So we don't need the ego. We don't need a projection that we think is greater than God. So we don't need to be addicted to the ego's advice. Right? We don't need to worship the ego. We don't need to keep trying to empower the ego by following its advice and worship, saying, yes, ego, I'm following your advice, as if it were God, as if the ego were God. We're trying to turn the ego into a God. It's only an idol. All attempts to empower our projections, our mental projections, psychic projections, is idolatry. All of it is idolatry. Okay? That's all it is. We're worshiping idols of our own making, thinking that we can make one that's so powerful, it protects us from God, defends us. So when we follow the ego's advice, we're just trying to empower an idol. That's it. So we can stop following the ego's advice. We have what seems to be a projection in the Holy Spirit to resolve the continuity problem for us. In other words, it's not a direct knowing. The Holy Spirit still seems to be something other than us, right? That is helping us, give us a remedy. Okay, it still seems that way. But it's the final projection, the final illusion. The only situation that actually works. And we'll understand this. But what is important is to, again, practice not taking the ego's advice. Saying no to the ego. No to this idol that we have tried to empower for so long. We're so used to idols, trying to empower idols, that we need something that we feel we can relate to somewhat on that level, which is what the Holy Spirit is, actually. It's an empowerment, it's a blessing that God gave upon our spirit. So we still refer to the Holy Spirit as something that is helpful to us, because we've been engaging with idols for such a long time, trying to empower idols for an incredibly long time, meaning following the advice of our projections. And what kind of advice do projections give us? Believe in the power of projections. Believe that projection is safety. That's what they tell us. Project more is what they tell us. And project your projection. and then attack the projection, attack and defend from that projection. That's what projection is, the advice. And so we get caught up in all this fragmentation, all this isolation, all this competition, all this defensiveness, all this kind of stuff, all this false remedy for it. We get enmeshed in that like a vast confusion, hall of mirrors. And so a technique which is super helpful, this conduit problem is a technique is super helpful. And whatever problem you can identify, you deny that problem. Accept the continuity problem. You transfer it all over to that. Say, I don't have a projection problem. I have a continuity problem. So that the ego can't engage you on that, right? Because the Holy Spirit simply leads us through right spiritual practice to experience the vision of oneness. That's it. It's an experience where you see everywhereness as primary. And thingness is no longer primary at all. In other words, location is no longer primary. However, you still are aware of things where they are. But the sense of location having meaning or relevance is gone. It's gone. Because you see, everyone is equally blessed. Equally blessed. So where they are, who they are, whatever their location is. I mean, really, whatever form is, it's just a location, actually. It's just a location in pure spaciousness. It's just saying, this is location. All the different appearances that form takes on are actually just an expression of location. It's an expression of location, trying to make location meaningful, primary, which is a denial, of course, of God, of everywhereness. It's saying that locationness is primary, and that everywhereness is secondary, that it only is a result of the location. It only kind of supports locationness. Okay, this is the upside. This is whimsical delusion. So the vision of oneness, we have this smoothed out feeling, a universal feeling. In other words, totally untouched by location. And yet we're still aware of things relative to other things. See, this person's there, that person's there, that person's there. But the feeling you have is completely universal, smoothed out universal feeling. It doesn't matter what location, as far as how you feel about anything at all, it makes no difference whatsoever. And we definitely can have the vision of oneness. In fact, for sure we will, and probably very soon. And what pulls us out of that is the habit of turning to the ego for advice is what pulls us out of that. We can have a vision of oneness, then we pull out of it. We say, whoa. I don't see any way to engage the ego in advice. There's no reason to turn to the ego advice at all, because location doesn't matter as far as how I feel. It doesn't matter at all. So why would I turn to the ego for advice? And the habit says, wait a minute, I need to have some reason to turn to the ego for advice. So I need to get back into thinking that location matters. It's primary, is what I mean, it's primary. And then you lose the vision of oneness, like that. That fades away from your awareness. Now, if you say location doesn't matter, why would you need to go to a realm of refuge? Because we are very, very fragile right now in terms of trying to get to a vision of oneness and then abiding in it and turning away from the vice of the ego. This world is a situation that is so intensely, you know, anti that, so intensely engrossed in error, in dualism at this point, that's a pragmatic step. It's a pragmatic step. Eventually, you will realize that location doesn't matter at all, and you'll be so established in that you will come to a perfect knowing of everywhereness. And at that point, you could come into a world like this and be unaffected by it. That's like a perfect teacher, a savior, an avatar, something like that. But we're not there at all. We're not there. So, of course we bow to pragmatism for you. Then that's fine. That's fine. Because it's pragmatically aligned with success. And it helps us not turn to the ego. You see? Now, the ego will say, well, you know, you need some help. Of course we need help, because we have this terrible habit of turning to the ego for advice. So the less problems we have, the less need to turn to the ego for advice. So if we live in a realm where it's very problem-free, that helps us not turn to the ego for advice. Whereas if we're in a world with just incredible problems, we're going to be desperately, you know, turning to the ego for advice. Our old habits will drag us down. So we have to say, I have a severe continuity problem, which means I do need pragmatic help on all levels, so to speak, including the physical problem, the level of the physical. I need help there too, because I have such bad habits, such terrible bad habits. See, the ego won't get us to admit we have this terrible bad habit of turning to it for advice. How could the ego say that's a terrible bad habit? It cannot. It won't say that, will it? The ego's not going to come to us and say, you know what, turning to the ego for advice is a terrible, ruinously terrible bad habit. You need to get free of that entirely. It won't say that, will it? Because it's just a projection that we're using to protect us from our initial projection, thinking that God is out to destroy us. So that projection, the ego will not say that. Will not say that. Our projections, which we, the totality we call the ego, will not say that to us. Only the Holy Spirit will tell us this. Now, the ego tells us that the more we turn to it to advice, the better off it will be for us, because we're empowering it. And so people are trying to turn to the ego at every possible juncture, putting their mind on violence and crime on television and horror and terribly suffering and misery and horrible situations and of gruesomeness and all this stuff, and then turn to the ego. Ego, what do I do with this? What do I do? What do I do? What do I do? You know, more and more and more. That's empowering the ego. It's empowering our defensive system against God, our defenses against God, which are totally not needed at all. So we need to exchange all of those type of defenses for the final defense, which is a defense that is so open, an open defense, as it were, a vision of oneness, that we still are aware of location, but it's very faint in our how we feel about all these forms is smoothed out, even the sameness, sameness, sameness. Universal joy, universal happiness, a universal happiness that is not based on location whatsoever, and yet we still see the form. That is the final defense, but it's a defense that enables us to remember the nature of reality so that we can even drop the notion that there is even such a thing as location, actually. Everything is actually pure spaciousness. There is no such thing as location in reality. So, but we're not ready for that final step yet. First, the vision of oneness, where we see still things, and yet we feel the smoothed out universal joy and happiness, bliss. It's called bliss. The smoothed out universal happiness is we call bliss, unaffected by location. And again, all forms are merely expressions of location. So it doesn't matter, the location of this plant spaciousness, it doesn't matter. This plant spaciousness as it is universal happiness, is smoothed out universal happiness. So this is spiritual practice, right spiritual practice. This day, the location of this day as it is does not matter. The location of this day does not matter. This day as it is the smoothed out expression of universal joy. This day as it is the smoothed out bliss of eternal life. As you practice with each location that you see, you practice this location, wherever you are. This location, the location of this location of this stonework, doesn't matter. Does not matter. The location of the stonework does not matter. This stonework, as it is the smoothed out bliss of now. Is the smoothed out bliss of now. As it is the smoothed out bliss of now. And so you get used to seeing this with each and everything you see. And so when the smoothed out bliss of the vision of oneness comes, you just say, yeah, yeah. Because that includes all locations. Right now we practice, you know, individual locations of where we are. And then we generalize and we can say this world, the location of this planet does not matter. This planet as it is the optimally smoothed out expression of pure bliss. This is right spiritual practice, okay? So it is possible to do this, even now, even here in this world, in this location we call the world, which is not a location at all, really. But we will, for solving the continuity problem, we will still refer to it that way. So this planet, this location, we call this planet, the location of this planet spaciousness, does not matter. This planet spaciousness, as it is the smoothed out, optimal expression of universal bliss. Now, it's hard to speak after this, really. I'm having a hard time even saying anything. It's hard, doesn't it? It's profound. Very profound. Now, this used to be apricot nectar. All right? And I drank it all, and then I washed it out, and I put water in it. But the washing didn't remove all the apricot nectar. When I drink it, there's a slight tinge of apricot nectar. Just a slight tinge. I say, and I can still taste a little bit of apricot nectar, but it's mostly water. And it's fine. It's great. That is very much like the vision of oneness, that there will remain a slight tinge of locationness, a slight tinge of locationness. Okay? Like a faint shadow, it's still there, but there'll be a slight tinge of it there, but the taste is still water, you know, it's still water. The taste is still this smoothed out bliss. Perfect example right there. Now, again, the rain of air, which is going to begin now. The battering, the physical battering from these dark clouds where the rain is now striking us. Its purpose is to deny, is to turn us to the ego, turning to the advice that the ego is the only path there is, and everything else is madness. That's what it's all about. It's all about empowering the ego, empowering this, our projections to defend ourselves against God, against what? Everywhereness, against pure spaciousness. So you don't want to subject yourself to that battering. You don't want to do it. You don't have to. Absolutely don't have to. You have my permission to avoid that, to sidestep it. Absolutely. You don't need my permission, but you certainly have it. Just like I give myself permission to avoid it. You see, the ego has leads us into conflict, and the ego, we turn, ego wants us to turn to it to advice, turn to it for advice, and say, who shall I attack? Who's my friend and who's my enemy? Who shall I attack? What location is trying to deprive me of my feeling of ultimate greatness? You see, where are those locations that are trying to deprive me of that? Let me go attack them and destroy them. Who are the ones that are trying to destroy me, thinking that I'm not the greatest location, you know, and this sort of thing. As long as we have a tinge of as long as we're so habituated to this, you see, we're so habituated to it, that it's difficult for us to entirely divest ourselves at this point of the feeling of we want a good location, okay? So pragmatically, being in a place that we feel is a problem-free location is helpful. It's helpful, a beautiful location. That is helpful at this point. But let the Holy Spirit provide that instead of our attempts to attack and acquire, you see. Our attempts to win, you know, to contest and win through our, you know, our psychic projections. Our psychic energy is superior to this psychic energy. We were able to, you know, get the prime place, because in this world you're going to have to defend it, right? You're going to have to defend it against others who say, wait a minute, their location is depriving me of what I should have, because I want to have the greatest location, so I'm after your location. This is what happens in the realm of projections, right? Whereas the Holy Spirit providing a location for us, it's not trying to take it away from us, right? There's not these battles going on, because everywhere will appear will be beautiful. And you say, wow, it's all beautiful. It's all beautiful. I don't care where you know you are. I'm happy where I am too. It's just the whole thing is beautiful. And there's much less strife. Much less strife. I have found that, like when you go to the place in this world that is like optimally beautiful in this world, there are some places that are optimally beautiful. I've been to at least one for sure. What you find out there is, you're willing to have just a little humble house there. It doesn't matter. The whole competition, who has the most grandest house, really starts paling. It seems to drop away a lot. And who has the best pool and the best this and that? It doesn't really matter that much, actually. That's what I felt. And the people are less competitive there in terms of, because you just look around, you say, whoa, we're all seeing the same beauty. You know, we're all like in the middle of this incredible oasis. You know, it's just like, who cares? Who cares about, what do we need to compete for? We're getting this, you know, beauty, this peace is so strong. It's like, wow, you don't really feel like trying to compete about location. Not so much. It's still there to a certain extent, but not so much. You're not that worried about it. Whereas if you're in a really lousy, ugly place with all this conflict and attack and danger, and it's this ugly, dark, you know, grimy, gritty, whatever, then, you know, people put this enormous significance on status of my house, my car, you know, what I have, my acquisition. Say, look, I was able to fashion a good location out of this hellish place. I'm so superior. And then people will envy them. There's envy, and they try to take it away from you. And there's competition and all this stuff. Whereas a place where everybody has this, you know, very beautiful view and location, everything, it's just like, you know, there's much less of that status competition. Much less worry about location, and there's easier to turn to spiritual practice then, because if you worry about location, you can just look out and say, whoa, look out, what incredible, you know, location. I'm already there in this incredible location. It's beautiful. Everywhere I go, it's stunningly beautiful. And you need to say, I can get right back to my spiritual practice and get the vision of oneness, where I see the entire universe and the universe of universes Location doesn't matter at all. It's all smoothed out beauty. Totally. Smoothed out bliss, happiness. But for some reason, those who are into projections and trying to afraid of God, they're all about trying to empower the best location in a sea of non-best locations. In other words, they want to triumph. They want to be the queen, the king. They want to be on top and the rest below them. And they want to see that out there is all this danger and ugliness, but they're able to maintain the beauty within this realm of all this strife and conflict, etc. And they want to have something better than others. They want to wear the crown. They want to be first. They want their location to be the premium location, and others less premium. And in other words, they want to have this entire, they want to be able to turn to the advice of the ego and keep empowering the ego, like, ego, how do I keep my kingdom? See, it's not enough to have this beautiful location. It's how do I defend it now? How do I defend it from attack? And so invariably, they will engage in trying to conquer other kingdoms to defend themselves. So they have to, it's not enough to have a prime location. They have to say, okay, I've got to acquire other prime locations. It's never enough. You look at these moguls, right? These super rich people. It's never enough. They have to acquire a bigger yacht and a bigger yacht and keep competing, keep competing, keep competing. They will always want more, because again, the defenses against God, believing that God is out to destroy us, no defense is adequate. So they keep feeling they have to keep empowering the ego by turning to it to advice, which means they feel vulnerable. Hey ego, how do I get more? How do I get more? How do I get a better location, ego? How do I get a better location? Where what the Holy Spirit does, it gives us a location that relaxes this whole competitiveness, and we say, you know what, this is good enough, this is fine, this is good enough as far as location goes, you know, it's beautiful, so beautiful, it's good enough. Let me now turn towards spiritual practice here, right? Spiritual practice. And you're not trying to acquire something even better, location-wise. So you have that, and you also have the pragmatic fact of in a place where you're not having someone trying to take over, you know, take over your location. You don't have all these warring factions taking place. There's no threat to your location at all, no threat. So you don't have to turn to the ego. There's that pragmatic fact also. So the realms of refuge, the refuge realms, we could very well find ourselves in such realms in very short order. Meanwhile, wherever we're at, we can practice. The place where I'm at right now is actually very, very beautiful, very, very simple, but very beautiful. And we basically practice of each thing we see, saying, the location of this tree, big tree here, the location of this big tree, spaciousness, the location of this tree, spaciousness, does not matter. It doesn't matter. The location of the tree, spaciousness, does not matter. This tree, spaciousness, as it is optimal. Smoothed out, sameness, universal joy, universal peace. So we can practice this wherever we are. Whatever thing, whatever location you're seeing, use that for the practice. Now, if I haven't explained this properly, that's fine. It's difficult because we have pragmatism, whereas the ego says, wait a minute, you're trying to go towards the ideal state or whatever. Yes, but we have the continuity problem, which is a pragmatic issue. So pragmatism does enter into the equation. And that's where the ego can argue with us, you see, you argue with us. You almost have to have a little faith in pragmatism, pragmatic situation. And it's difficult to iron this out entirely. But the fact is, we still have a dependency on location to some extent. And if that's not addressed in the right way by the Holy Spirit, it can lead to troubles. It can lead to troubles, no question about it. So again, fundamentally, we say I have a very severe problem. It's the continuity problem. This has to be addressed on all levels by the Holy Spirit, including the location level. Including the location level. If we're at a place where people are beating down our doors, you know, SWAT teams are beating down our doors, it's hard to do our spiritual practice, right? If our home is being foreclosed on, it's hard to engage in spiritual practice, right? Yes. If we can't make our payments and we're going to bankruptcy, it's hard to focus on our spiritual practice. That's just pragmatically fact. The ego has designed all these crises to get us to turn to the ego for advice. So it's pragmatically helpful if we have a living place, a situation, where we do not have all these crises. Well, the ego will scream, that's not fair, it's not fair, and of course it's angry, because then we don't need to turn to the ego for advice. We don't need to try and empower the ego to deal with these problems. Now, further along on this, California, where I live, it has been foreseen for a long time as like the ultimate place on this planet, which is why there's so many people here. People from all over the world have flocked to California, because it is probably the best place on the planet as far as the beauty and the climate and all of that. It's optimal, it is. But it has extreme problems, actually, what I've found. It's not good enough. It's actually, I had an incredibly difficult time here. But you do get this tinges of feeling like, wow, this is like an optimal location. And people here are frantically moving about California looking for, where is this optimal place? I mean, I've done that. I've gone all over the state, you know. Here, you know, is it climbing Mount Shasta? You know, is it going to Death Valley? I mean, Death Valley is like, can be, you know, incredibly beautiful, the spaciousness there. Is it going up the Eastern Sierras, you know, up Alabama Hills and Lone Pine? Is it going to Monterey Bay? Is it going to San Francisco? You know, is it going so many places? Is it going to the Sequoia National Forest? Is it going to the Antelope Valley poppy fields? Is it just simply sailing on you know, in San Francisco Bay, or stay in a like a summer-like day in February? And it goes on and on and on and on and on and on here. Going to the beach in December. Really, I mean, Los Angeles was like 90, almost 90. In January at the beach. And so people are just, you know, just basking. It's like, they think, wow, what a great location, right? So what I found is it's not good enough. It's not good enough. Is it playing on a private golf course in December in 80 degree weather with everything just green and sparkling, which, you know, I've done. You can do that. You can do all this stuff here. But, what is California facing right now? An extremely problematical drought. An extremely problematical drought. Can I grow my garden this year? Probably not. Do I have to stop watering the plants? Maybe. Can I grow a lot of flowers? Probably not. Am I going to see a lot of things die? Probably. If this drought continues, Californians are going to be in an incredible crisis, actually. And it is continuing. Today is like another summer day, almost. It's a beautiful spring day. There's not a hint of rain. We got a little drizzle over the weekend, and that's it. And they say the next 10 days, probably none. If March doesn't rain, then it's very likely that April showers are not going to do anything. Then we're into May already. And then there may be no more rain all the way through what, till next December. And it may not even rain then. We're gonna run out of water. The state is going to run out of water. The agricultural business is going to be, and they're gonna be pumping from wells as much as possible, but that's gonna severely deplete that. And the whole state is going to be in this panic crisis mode, actually. So what good is this Golden State? What good is this location when things like that can happen? What good is it? It's not good enough. It's still an egoic optimal location. So let the Holy Spirit give a Holy Spirit optimal location where there isn't going to be any such thing as a drought, okay? There's not going to be any such thing as a pestilence. You're not going to have the boar beetles coming in. You're not going to have plagues striking you. You're not going to have a bureaucracy saying, you know, monitoring your energy usage, everything you do. Not going to have that. You're not going to have massive people pouring in illegally into where you live, so there's a so you have huge traffic jams everywhere. You're not going to have the price of gas skyrocket, which is going to do, it's going to jump 50 cents in the next couple weeks here. Can you imagine that, living in California? Gas suddenly goes up, 50 cents a gallon goes up in a matter of a couple weeks. Why? Because we have to watch the quality of the air. Why? Because there's too many cars here. Why? Because everybody has to have a car to get anywhere here. Plus, they're all constantly moving about trying to find the optimal location here. It's a nightmare. I would prefer simply to have an electric golf cart as my means of transportation. I don't even forget about a car. Have a little local market, a beautiful golf course, a beautiful area. Just drive your little electrical golf cart to the market. You know, pick up a few groceries, go back to your little simple house. That's all I need. It's like a simple retirement community or something like that. And the place you're at is so beautiful, you don't need to be going driving all over. I mean, Californians drive so much, constantly. They're in their RVs, they're traveling all over the place. They're going up to Washington, Oregon, Alaska, Canada, Nevada, Arizona. They're just, you know, constantly taking trips. I mean, this place where I live here on weekends, it's like deserted. Everybody's out of town. Everybody's out of town going places. Burning. Carbon footprint is just unbelievable here. Building, remodeling. It's never enough. Their location's never good enough, right? So they just build bigger and bigger houses, more and more. Better cars, bigger, more luxury. Constantly. Competing. Status, location. Now what I've found is, for me, it's like, give me just this beautiful park-like setting, maybe a beautiful golf course or something. And I don't need to go to all these others. And I found that I have one place where I go, and I don't need to go to the other places. I've stopped going, trying to find all these different golf courses. I don't care. I've seen them. I said, doesn't matter. This one's good enough. It's good enough. I don't need to go to all these other places. It's good enough. So in your location, you feel, you know what? This is good enough. It's good enough. I don't need to go searching for other locations. Is good enough. That's pragmatic. It's good enough. And I don't have all these concerns. Oh my gosh, we're not going to be able to water the lawn. It's all going to die. I went through a drought before in California. We let everything die in our yard. The lawn, everything died. It was horrible. It took us 20 years to recover from that. And now we finally recovered, and now here comes another drought. You know, that's life in California. It breaks your heart. California is the ultimate heartbreaker, I'm telling you. Absolutely terrible living here. It's a heartbreaker. At least in other places, you know it's terrible. You don't expect anything. But what California does, it gets your expectations sky high, and then it, you know, shatters your dream here. Broken dreams here. Because it's never, the location here is never good enough, actually. Zoning changes come in. They push a freeway through. They change the schooling, the rules, you know, it's just a constant. People here are so ambitious and aggressive. The way they drive, you know, it's just unbelievable. I was just talking about how people are running red lights. And then right in front of us, there's a left turn lane, and it turns red. And there's this car who's like 20, 30 feet away or whatever, going slowly, they cut over from another lane. It's red. And they just drive right on through it because they see there's no traffic coming. It was at nighttime. They say, what the heck? I don't need to stop. I'll just go. Drove right through the red light into the shopping center. And we all just saw it. He says, there you go. That's California right now. People are so frantic to get premium locations. And the prices here are driving people out of the state. Lifelong residents can no longer afford to stay here. I mean, what is the price to even rent like an apartment in San Francisco? On the peninsula, someone told me, the going rate for these apartments, $4,000 a month for an apartment, a small little apartment, $4,000 a month. Who can even afford to live here? Only the super ambitious, the super ruthless can even afford to live here in the future as far as moving into the state. So there's this frantic competition where you say, I'm not going to stop at a red light. I'm just going to cut in front of this person. I'm not going to let them in. So you get this incivility building up in California, which makes the quality of life here really terrible, the stress terrible, because, what good is a beautiful location if everybody's rude and angry and caught up in their own ego trip and are uncivil to you and want to take advantage of you and stuff? How can you enjoy your beautiful location if that's the case? So one facet of a useful location, not only is it beautiful, but it extends there's no boundary to the extension of it. So no matter how many people come in, there's room for everyone to spread out and feel that they're not being crowded, and they're not going to have their location taken away from them based on scarcity and competition. So it has to be a realm that extends. And that lessens this whole, and people can be very civil to one another. You'd be surprised how civil, when you get out of the rat race, people are much more civil. They're not frightened you're going to take your location away from you. And then that helps you settle down and say, wait a minute, we don't need to really worry about location anymore. Let's shift to seeing that pure spaciousness is primary, and location actually doesn't even matter as to how I feel. Then you can make that shift. It's easier to make that shift. It's easier. So the California nightmare, it has just been, it has been a nightmare, because you think you almost got it, and then suddenly it gets snatched away from you. I remember the first, the gas crisis, the oil embargo, and that was horrible, because, you see, part of the California dream was cheap energy prices. So we thought nothing of jumping in a car for every weekend and traveling hundreds of miles. Let's go camping. Oh, go up to Yosemite. Go up to Yosemite. Oh, sure, jump in the car, go to Yosemite. Gas was 19 cents a gallon. What would you burn? You'd burn like maybe 40 gallons or something of gas. Oh, maybe you spend $20 on gas for this this incredible road trip, right? Incredible road trip. And so you could afford to take these road trips all the time and not even worry about it, not even thought about it. Gas was so cheap. When the oil embargo hit, the gas lines, what is this? Gas lines? It freaked us out. It was horrible. I worked as a gas station attendant, pumping back when we pumped gas during this oil embargo crisis. And I had to fill up these lines stretch for hundreds of cars at every pump, you see. There are many stations, right? I had to service all these stations by myself. So I was running from car to car to car, pumping gas for each car all day long for 8 to 10 hours a day, with people completely freaking out and so angry and upset. You talk about stress. You talk about blowing someone's dream to smithereens. This is what I had to deal with. And everyone hated on you. Like, why is gas so expensive? How come there's such this terrible line? How come my dream is being ruined? And you just, you know, I got this immense hostility from all these Californians because their dream was being ruined. You know, they hated it. So that was just, you know, one example. One example. And there's been many such examples. We get really upset here in California when anything interferes with our dream of a perfect location here. And stuff keeps interfering with it. And this drought is going to be just a mind blower here. I already feel, you know, the future here in California is just like a nightmare, actually. A nightmare. The economy could crumble. The industries could crumble. And you're going to get, what you're going to get is super rich people from all over the world are going to pour in here and buy up all this stuff. They're already doing it. A lot of the houses and property being built, being bought in California right now are being bought by Chinese and by Arabs. Okay, people from other countries who have a ton of cash, and they're paying cash. No loans at all, cash for everything. Cash. And they bring a very different value system into the state. Very different mindset, very aggressive, very materialistic, very acquisitive, very walling off themselves, you know, very isolationist, very, you know, just the whole mood of the state is changing incredibly, to an incredible extent, along with all the techies coming from all over the world, focused on their thing. You know, the way it used to be is so gone, so far gone. It used to be so mellow and civil here, and you see someone, you wave, say hi, how you doing today, and they wave back, hi, how you doing, great to see you, how's everything, strangers, you walk in a store and they'd be greeted, hi, never seen you before, hey, come on in, good to see you, how's life, you know, how you doing, and oh, great, how are you, you know, and you'd sit there and you'd talk, and say, ah, what a great day it is, huh? Unbelievable. What a great place this is, isn't it? Aren't we fortunate? That's how we talk in California. We'd say, gosh, aren't we incredibly fortunate to be here, Mike? This is just, I mean, we're so blessed to live here. This is so amazing, you know? And they say, yeah, so amazing. And we felt we were blessed. We felt we were blessed, and we felt other people were blessed. Don't feel that way anymore. Now we're just feeling like, how do we survive the commute? I mean, all these rich techies are like freaking out right now. They really are. They're just going ballistic because they paid for special, they paid to be able to drive in diamond lanes and they paid a premium, all right? And now that's being revoked from them because the diamond lane is now just as slow as all the other lanes. And they're furious about it because it doesn't matter how much money they have. They cannot get special privilege here to get to work half an hour quicker than everyone else. And they're furious. And the rest of us. I mean, they're now stuck in this horrible commute with the rest of us, where it takes you 2 hours to get to work. You can't even afford to live in San Francisco. So you gotta live out in the Central Valley somewhere, and it takes you at least 2 hours to get to work, 2 hours to get, 4 hour commute every day. How much fun is that? With everybody jostling each other, you know, in line, in this traffic jam. People frantically trying to, you know, get one car ahead of you. Like, I'm making progress, I cut in. You get these other people where you have exits, where you have these kind of exits where they're long exits, and then there's a long freeway ramp also going off this road onto the freeway, and that you can go through to like, if you're going east or west on this road, if you're going east, you take the long ramp and then turn off immediately. If you're going west, you continue over the road for a long ways and then loop around and go west. And you can also continue straight to get back onto the freeway. So the people that are coming from a certain road could go down the freeway. And these are long, long stretches, actually. What people are doing now is they're acting like they're exiting. And they just actually keep going straight and then re-enter the freeway like a half a mile, a quarter mile ahead, and they've saved like 10 minutes of commute or whatever. And you get a lot of people are doing that now. And other people are now furious at those people. How dare they? They're cheats. At metering lights where you get on the freeway, it's all bad. You're saving yourself 20 minutes of time. And I'm seeing so many people, sometimes half the people are cheating on that. And they're just saying, doesn't matter. If I get caught, I pay the fine. I just got to save 20 minutes. And of course, you're getting furious seeing this. My town here used to be so mellow. It's gridlock now. When you're afraid to go down, I'm afraid to go down this road because I know you're going to hit gridlock there and you're going to waste 10, 15, 20 minutes. It takes me a half an hour just to get on the freeway now, whereas it should take 5 minutes. Half an hour. You drive for lunch at 12:30, you hit gridlock. And people are just like, God, you can see, you know, they're just like freaking out. This is what's happening in California, folks. This is, along with this terrible drought. We're not happy here with our location. It sucks, it is terrible. But still, we look at the weather and we say, oh my God, it's so beautiful here. The greenery, the plants, everything is so awesome. And yet, I'm stuck in a four-hour commute. I've got crazy drivers cutting in front of me, missing their kamikaze drivers everywhere. I'm afraid I'm gonna get an accident every day. I'm totally stressed out about driving here. The price of gas is gonna spike 50 cents a gallon. The drought is, it's just like, whoa, you know. We got crime rate is spiking everywhere here. People are rude, they're uncivil. Everyone has this attitude, like they're superior to you. You know, the whole quality of life is crumbling, crashing down around us. That's what's happening. That's just for starters. Price of food is going to skyrocket. Many of us are not going to even be able to stay here. We'll get, I don't know where in the world we would go, you know, maybe down to some place where everything is dirt cheap and also crime is completely severe and everything is just like utterly trashy, you know, just terrible. Can you imagine a Californian having to go live in such, it's like, we'd rather be dead, really. It's like an utter nightmare. So, you got trouble in paradise, to say the least here. So what I'm saying, a long way of saying, locations on this planet, this situation, locations here are always severely problematical. And instead of doing spiritual practice, we all thought coming to California we would be able to engage in spiritual practice. There's so many spiritual teachers came out here, so many teachers from all over the world showed up in Los Angeles, Hollywood, San Francisco, Mount Shasta, I mean, all these areas, so many, and people from spiritual seekers from all over the world came here because they thought they could engage. This is the place to engage in spiritual practice. There's no question about that. That's why all these spiritual movements came out of California. But it never really happened. It didn't happen. Because we kept saying, well, wait a minute, I'm not quite there yet, or a little bit took place. But as far as really, really, really following through on it, it didn't happen. That is a lesson that we learned here. It didn't happen. Because they say, well, it's not, you know, there's all these changes coming, there's all these people coming, there's competition, wait a minute, how do I keep this, how do I improve this, and they never really got around to it. It never really happened here. It didn't really happen here. And my situation is pretty unique in that I've just like a super, super, super determined person, and I was going to succeed no matter what. And so I just grinded it out every day. I just isolated myself in a room and says, let me just keep working on it. I don't care. Just going to keep working on it. And it's brutally difficult, actually, because everybody else was out still trying to find a slightly better location. And they didn't get it done. They kept thinking, no, we just make it a little better, the state a little better. This is this whole ideology of making the world a better place. If we just make it a little better, you end up never getting it done here. Don't get it done. And I, you know, of course I was caught up in that to some extent. I tried to make this yard like optimal place, optimal place, optimal place. And at some point, you know, I just said, it's good enough, it's good enough. And let's just get down to practice now, intense practice, and just keep doing it every day, every day. I got this very little spot here, very nice. Leave the rest of it the way it is, you know. Don't try to make it all nice. It's good enough. So if you can get to this state of saying, you know, it's good enough, it's good enough. Problem is everyone here is constantly passing you by, and you know, you're running into all these issues. That getting to the store, trying to find parking, you know, is becoming a nightmare. People are not civil. People are super caught up in status here. Like, you're nothing if you don't project a certain status aura, you know. It's unbelievable how people are caught up in this whole status thing of location and acquisitions and material possessions. Just, it's a mania. It's a mania here. So that is really difficult, you know. What I did was smart, pragmatic. I have a little spot here. I put, you know, just this little spot here I made very beautiful. And then what I did was I got a few shirts that are good quality, high quality, and that's all. I just wear those. So I don't try to keep up with fashion. Fashion here is an extreme demand. Extreme demand. You can appear out of fashion just, you know, in a matter of weeks or something. Everybody is here wearing stuff they've ordered from all over the planet, actually. And they shop at these very expensive stores. And you know, you look at their shoes, what do they get these shoes? I don't even know where you get these clothes. But they order them online, they're aware of all these, you know, they order them from Italy, and from Europe, all over the planet, they'll order stuff. And it's just amazing, you know, the cars. That, I mean, like now, you see, what is the car that you see most here? Expensive Audis. Just taking over the whole place is these new Audis. That's the new in car, you know, and Teslas. Teslas everywhere. And so you just get, you know, your car, you look at your car, it's completely out of date. Your clothing, totally out of date. And you just feel like, wow, I must not have a very good location. But what I do is I just get classic, like classic clothing, classic shirts, very simple. And just keep this sort of classic, simple, basic look. It's just good enough. It's a little trick. And it's good enough. It is just a pragmatic little trick type of thing that just keeps me from worrying about the pressure and demands here too much. And as far as keeping up with the pressure of the Joneses, as far as your property and everything like that, you do a few little things that juice it up a little bit, and you say, okay, that's good enough. And you go retro. What I did was have a garden. And now, you know, just, and it's a very simple garden, and it's not like all the smooth landscaping, okay? It's not, no. It's a garden, vegetable garden, but it's retro, it's old style California, right? But people seeing it, and it's such a good garden, actually. They're all like, whoa, this is incredible, you know, amazing. Look at the status. I wish I had one. That's everybody's. I wish I had this. All these very rich people, you know, because it's retro. You see, it's showing like a time when things were peaceful and calmer and slower here, which is what everybody wants here. So that's another little pragmatic technique that I used. to take the pressure off of trying to landscape all this stuff and keep up with the landscaping and have a garden or all this stuff. No. You let the rest of the stuff just kind of just go, be as it is. And you say, I'm just being retro. So I'm not keeping up with technology. I don't have a smartphone. I don't have a tablet. I don't have all this stuff that people are getting. Can't afford it. Can't afford to keep up here. But you say, no, it's a retro style, you know. And that has a slight, you can slightly get away with that to a little extent, sort of. Just enough. A few little things that enable you to keep your spiritual practice going here, but it's really tough, really tough. It used to be, what I used to do, I just didn't go out in public. I just didn't go out at all. Stayed away, stayed in my room. And therefore, there was no pressure. I didn't feel much pressure to keep up in the rat race, because I just didn't expose myself to it at all. But eventually, that became impossible to keep up. The pressure was too much. So then I had to shift gears to a little stonework. You put a little stonework in, because everybody's crazy about stonework everywhere. Stone houses, you know, stone walls, whatever, you know, to do a little stonework. So you say, oh, I got a nice little stonework. Do a little landscape lighting, so I have a little bit of this. Having, you know, just a little touches of this without overdoing it. And then be a little retro, and people can kind of say, ah, maybe they're ahead of me. You know, this is the avant-garde. I think I see something here that is, you know, you get a little slack, maybe a little slack. A little bit, just enough so you can still breathe, actually. So still breathe a little, and then do the spiritual practice. It's all about how you feel about yourself, right? If you feel okay keeping up appearances, that's good enough. But it's extremely difficult to maintain that balance, actually. It's super easy to get sidetracked. Oh, I have to have this. Oh, I have to have this. Because everybody here, they're all projecting this thing like, I am in the optimal location. Look at me, I'm optimally located. I'm better than you. I'm more optimal in my location than you are. Everybody's projecting that. It would take a saint to not be bothered by that, you know? It would take someone established in the vision of one that's actually established in it to not be affected by that here. It's like a plague. It's a plague here. And it's coming from all over the world. The people that come here are the most ambitious, most aggressive, most status conscious, most people in the whole planet are coming here, because this is where the key jobs are, the best jobs in the world, really. You get these super smart, ambitious graduates from Stanford and Harvard and these MBAs, you know, come here, these people who say, because this is where you make a fortune. This is where the billionaires are made. They're all after that billionaire thing. They're all after it. And they're super strategic and ruthless, and they just say, they project, I have the optimal location. And how they dress, how they act, everything is this projection. Now, of course, in LA, it's all about I'm a star. And they project this star quality. Everybody from LA projects this star quality. I used to work in a place that was in between the Bay Area and LA area. And people from both areas would come to where I was, visit. I could always tell the difference. It's completely obvious. People from the north are projected this thing is like, I'm super successful. I'm super smart, sophisticated, successful, and super rich. They projected this. The people from the LA area always projected, I'm a movie star. I'm super popular. I'm super popular. I'm a great person. I'm a star. They projected, but always, 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 I could always tell they'd come up in their car. I didn't know, you know, they'd walk in and before you know, right away I'd say, you're from Southern California, aren't you? They'd say, how'd you know? Because they'd come in like, I'm here. I'm a star. Friendly. Very friendly. Very friendly. Do you recognize me, that I'm a movie star? I was on TV. What they really mean is, I was in a TV audience once down there. Yeah, I was at a taping of the such and such show. Yeah, sure, I saw, Jay Leno. I saw Jay Leno at dinner 3 years ago. And this is what they're like. They say, hi, how are you? Shake your hand. And you say, wow, you're shaking the hand of a star. You know that? A celebrity. I'm actually a celebrity. Really? Oh, yeah. I was having lunch at the, some place, and Jay Leno walked in. Did you know that? I saw Jack Nicholson just, 5 years ago, actually. As a matter of fact, I was in a charity event that Jack Nicholson was running. Yeah. Nice to meet you. In other words, what they're saying is, you're meeting a star, a celebrity. How fortunate for you. That is the total LA attitude, believe me. Every single one from LA was like that. It was incredible. And the ones from Northern California, totally different. It's like they come in and say, who are you? Who are you? Yeah. I'm super successful and smart, and I'm on the fast track to being a billionaire. Who are you? Who are you? You're nobody. You're nobody. That's their attitude. Who are you? Totally different. See, the LA people want to impress you like a game host, hi, come on down. Nice to see you, How's the family? They're the host. They're the celebrity host. That's their role. People from Northern California, it's like, I'm more successful than you are. I'm way more successful than you are. I'm way more successful than you are. Who are you? Why am I talking to you? I got more important things to do than talk to you. That's the Bay Area attitude, Northern California attitude. I got the prime location. You don't. I'm successful. I'm more successful than you. I don't need to talk with you. I don't want you around me. I want to be around you. I want to be around successful people like me. I'm very successful. So it was like night and day. You could tell a difference. I used to think the LA people are better, but not really, because they're saying they're the celebrity. You're the audience member. You're an audience. Always that you are their audience. So of course they're on stage. Is that nice to see, audience? How's everybody today? They're the star. They're the star, of course. And I was like, wow. What a world. So that winds it up nicely here. Nice little vignette of that location here is a nightmare. It's a nightmare. If you really go into the realms of asylum, refuge, the realms of refuge, it's a different story. That is optimal, as far as location can be optimal. And so you don't have this ferocious battle taking place here. So for me, I know California is not good enough, for sure. For sure. No place on this planet, really, that's optimal, for sure. I mean, look what happened to Tibet, You think Tibet was optimal? I mean, isolated, protected. We thought Tibet was, Shambhala. It's in Tibet, right? You go to Shambhala, you're able to do your spiritual practice, no problem. What happened in, was it 1955 or 6, 55 or 56, I'm around there. What happened to Tibet? There's another big lesson. right? Where is Shambhala? We're thinking, where is Shambhala? If I just find the right location, everything will be great. But first, put your spiritual practice first, wherever you are. See, I'm showing you, wherever you are, you can do the right spiritual practice, and you can generalize it for the entire globe. I'm also saying it is possible. And from a pragmatic standpoint, it's helpful. It's not the final thing. You still have to do your spiritual practice. There's no question. You still have to get the vision of oneness. Let's make that very clear. I don't care what location you're in. It could be the most beautiful location in the world. And I've actually been where I think is the most beautiful location in the world. And it was incredible. I simply wanted to stop there and not move. I said, I don't need to move or go anywhere. I'm just going to stand right where I am, and this is it. I'm just going to stay right here. And I'm going to now extend this feeling universally. So, you still have to do your spiritual practices, even in the incredibly beautiful location. It just makes it easier. You have to get to the vision of oneness where you see location doesn't matter at all. For the whole, universally. Everyone, no matter what they think the location is equally blessed, is equally one, equally has eternal life. There's absolutely no difference whatsoever, none. You do have to get to that realization. So that, let me make it very clear, that no matter if you're in the optimally beautiful location, spiritual practice is still the order of the day, without question. Without question. But it makes it easier, because you just say, I just want to sit right here. This is, I don't need to go anywhere. Let me just sit where I am. It's good enough. And then let me start my spiritual practice right here, because this is good enough for me. My God, this is incredibly peaceful and beautiful. I don't care. If someplace else is better, this is good enough. I'm happy, this is good enough for me. All right, let's start spiritual practice right now. And let us spend 8 hours at it, you know? That's what can happen. All right, so this is enough for this video. It is President's Day, 2014. I was told you got to make a big push for this day. You've got to be really amp up your readiness and your clarity. I've done it. And what I've seen is we're going to start to be struck by this rain of error is going to start battering us now. The world is going to start being battered. And it's going to get worse and worse and worse. So, from this point forward, we will see what happens. And that's enough for this video. Very great, that's it. The location of these palm trees, this palm tree spaciousness does not matter. This palm tree spaciousness as it is self-released. Spaciousness does not matter. This mountain spaciousness as it is optimally smoothed out eternal life blissfulness. The location of the sky spaciousness does not matter. This sky spaciousness as it is optimally smoothed out, blissful eternal life. The location of this grassy spaciousness doesn't matter. Does not matter. Location does not matter. This grassy spaciousness as it is the self-released, optimal, smoothed out blissfulness of eternal life. This little glade, spaciousness, as it is, this little glade spaciousness, the location of this little glade spaciousness doesn't matter. The location of this little glade spaciousness here doesn't matter. Does not matter. This little glade spaciousness, as it is smoothed out, optimal, same, vast, blissful nowness. This log spaciousness here, the location of this log spaciousness doesn't matter. Location of this log spaciousness doesn't matter. This log spaciousness, as it is the self-release, vast, smoothed out spaciousness of eternal life. Location of this bridge spaciousness. The location of this bridge spaciousness doesn't matter. This bridge spaciousness, as it is the optimally smoothed out joy of eternal life. The location of this concrete spaciousness, this concrete spaciousness, doesn't matter. This concrete spaciousness, as it is the optimally smoothed out vastness of universal nowness. This pillar, okay, this, the location of this pillar doesn't matter. The location of this pillar doesn't matter. This pillar, as it is the self-released presence of vast joy and happiness. This vista as it is, the location of this road doesn't matter. The location of this vista doesn't matter. The location of this spaciousness doesn't matter. This spaciousness, as it is the self-released omnipresence of joyful eternal life. The location of this vista does not matter. The location of this vista does not matter. This vista, as it is perfectly smoothed out, sameness, happiness of eternal life. The location of this fairway doesn't matter. The location of this fairway does not matter. This fairway, as it is the smoothed out vastness of eternal life joy. This is it. This is. This hill vista, the location of this hill vista, doesn't matter. The location of this hill vista doesn't matter. It is as it is. It is as it is. The smoothed out vastness of eternal life. It is as it is, the smoothed out vastness of eternal life.